partners this morning, and I can tell you I had tears in my eyes. We were alone in the room when I saw everybody filling the room. And it's the same sensation that I have every single day. When I'm sitting, you know, we have our latest project is something called Tawle, which we call the farmer's kitchen. I don't call it restaurant because in the list of forbidden words like concept and restaurant, restaurant is one of the words that you don't use. We'd rather say farmer's kitchen. So it's like in a dead end alley, and like I sit in the corner. This is like my office there. I don't have a proper office. And every day when I see people coming in for lunch, I say, well, we're still doing the right thing, and people are still responding, and like it's very reassuring for me. It's a wonderful event. I'm not going to say Crone and all the organizers, because I think they are just doing their job. It is when we have the power of money, politics, or recognition, it is what are we going to do of it? Are we going to make more of the same? Or if we received more, it doesn't mean what are we going to do to receive more and more, but what are we going to do to give more? I learned from my yesterday's friend, Alan Jenkins, that King Frederick, who's a Danish king, like in the Second World War, when people had to work towards the yellow star, he was the first who wanted to wear it. So it is how to set an example as a leader. How can each one of us, you know, make a change? How to hear always in my head, you know, what Gandhi said, be the change you want to see. It's not just, you know, about asking others, you know, what the state did for me, what the others did for me, what my father did for me, what my superior did for me. It is what each and every one of us can do. Jacqueline's going to talk like just after me, just gave me the small pot of honey, you know. It's a project that she will tell everything about, but I think it's a project of, you know, honey production in cities. And this is, she tried, and her organization tried to make a change through a small pot of honey who is being produced by homeless in cities. So this is definitely nothing, you know, but this has been produced by millions of bees. Can you imagine, if you remember, how honey is produced, guys? You know, like it's every drop by drop who is, you know, transported by each single bee. And each single bee don't think, you know, about politics or religion or nothing at all. They just do what they have to do. So how can we just do what we have to do, and how I hope what we are doing is the correct and right thing. I'm going to tell you a small story about a very small adventure in a very small country called Lebanon. Lebanon is not bigger than, you know, 10,000 square kilometers. It's nearly as big as Long Island. And it's nearly a million, it's less than a million people in the city in Beirut, and 5 million in the whole country. And it's, you know, it makes such a stir, sometimes I wonder why. But sometimes I say, like, it's quite unique. It's quite a unique case, not just because I'm Lebanese, you know, and you know we're more like peacocks as Lebanese, maybe as Mediterranean. But I think it's quite a unique case because I'm gonna show just, you know, like images that will, it's a slideshow that will go on, and just tell a little bit, show you some pictures about what we do. So just to situate the country a little bit before, I think Lebanon is quite a unique country because it's a country where the concept of the other does not exist. In all other countries in the world, there's a majority and a small minority, the others, you know, black and white, Christian and Muslim, green and yellow, you know, like anything about religion, about race, about anything. Lebanon is the only place where the concept of the other does not exist. Who is the other and who is the main? Are they Christian or Muslim as of religion? Are they sea people or mountain people? Are they people looking to the east or people looking to the west? It's all of these together. It's none of these and all of these together. It's really a half and half country, which makes it so wonderful because so diverse, you know, but at the same time so fragile. Because the second one part gets a little bit stronger than the other, it would like to, you know, eradicate or erase the other. So what we try to do is first of all say, like, fair enough, our latest war was from 1975 till 1991, and we killed each other because our ethnic, our religious, you know, and our political differences. And then, you know, like, I'm a son of farmers and producers, and I said, what can we do to bring all of these people together? I'm not going to talk about food or food quality, you know, or gastronomy. I'm just going to talk about people, wonderful producers who are first of all human beings. So what we try to do is like to find a common ground between all of these diverse and different people. Difference can be a reason to make war and to kill each other, or we can just celebrate diversity. Celebrate diversity, see what's different between me and him, and say, fair enough, this is the differences between both of us, we can kill each other because of this, or we can say, both of us, you know, like honey. So this is a common ground we can build around. So the land, the product of the land, the agriculture, and the cuisine was this common ground between all these diverse people. People in different regions of Lebanon, whether they are in the north or in the south, they had no religious difference at all in their food tradition. Obviously, Muslims would not maybe drink a lot of alcohol or eat pork, but many Christians too at the same time don't eat much pork in this part of the world maybe, or drink or do not drink alcohol. So other than that, it is like absolutely the same traditions. There's a big difference between regional differences, because Lebanon is a very small country, but still, you know, it has a coast of 200 kilometers, with a coastal plain and a very different climate and food production and cuisine. Then there are high mountains that climb to 3,000 meter altitude, and it's a completely different drastic production, cuisine, and agriculture. And then below, it's the Bekaa Valley, who is like just an avant-goût to what's inland and the desert of the inland is going to be. So it was about how can you bring all of these different people around a common project. We started in 2004 with a farmer's market. It was like a very, very simple step. Wonderful producers all around the country doing great work, but who would like to have tomato and tomato village? You know, it was how to bring the producer from rural areas to urban areas where there's a demand and a purchasing power. So in 2004, we started the first farmer's market in Lebanon, in Beirut. And someone was just asking me, what's the difference between a farmer's market and a souk? All Oriental souks are wonderful places, but it's more like, you know, open air malls where you have more resellers than producers. What we wanted to do in this project was about putting the people, the producers first, you know. It was about the people and what they do and not just their production. So it's a producers only market. It's a direct relation between the consumer and the producer. It's pride and recognition for the producer, and it is an important economical return for the producer himself. And for the consumer, it's very important to understand that food is not just a commodity that you buy with money. You don't just go get a job, make money, and go buy food. Food is not something you buy. Food is something that our parents produced, planted, or cooked. If we can't do it ourselves, you know, anymore, at least have a direct contact with the person who's doing it. So the project began as a farmer's market in 2004, and it was straight away like a meeting place for people. People used to come with their, and are still coming with their, you know, kids and family on a Saturday morning. It's every Saturday morning, it's the beginning of weekend. And it got to be, you know, like a meeting place and an educational place in the center of the city. From that, we moved to something else, which is education in schools, where it was important, you know, to give something else to the children. Children are just like a sponge, you know, like whatever we put in them, they are going to give back. So what they see, what they listen, and what they eat, it's what's going to form them and to make them. And from that step, in 2007, we said, well, all of this is wonderful, but we would like to go and discover the producers themselves in their own villages. What can we do? So we created what we call Food and Feast, which are regional food festival, which is a move in a contrary direction, a move from urban to rural, where we would go to a village, you know, if it's very well known for its tomato, to the tomato village here, the cherry village there, or the fish festival in another village. So all of this is very important to give, you know, pride and recognition to the producer himself, to the peasant, so the peasant knows, you know, he's not like just the bottom of the pyramid. The pyramid has no bottom and no top. We are all just, you know, contributing by whatever we're doing. In Islam, there's a saying where they say, each act is an act of prayer. You don't need to go to a church or to a mosque to pray. Whatever you're doing, you're a writer, whatever you write, you know, it's an act of worship. You're cooking, whatever you're doing, you know, you're just, it's an act of worship in whatever you're doing, if you're doing it in the best, perfect way possible. So as of 2007, we started these different activities in the villages, and it's always, you know, about empowering producers, about, you know, meeting the producers, about bringing an important income and recognition to the producers. And this project here is called Khibz Mulah. It's bread and salt that we did 4 years ago with a lady who's giving, Maria Vogelzang, who's a wonderful Dutch food designer, who's giving, I think, just now a workshop for kids about vegetables. So Maria came to Lebanon like for a week, and we did a workshop about what was the food memory for people. It was like 50 producers and people from all around the country. And it was about thinking what was the food, the war food memory they had. And everybody had the same war food memory. It was bread. Because the second the war or problems started, people just ran away to bakeries to buy bread, to stock bread in their houses. So what we did together is like, we each one like baked his bread, we shaped it into like a bowl, we colored it into green with parsley juice because the green line was divided between East Beirut and West Beirut. And this is where the Souq al-Tayyib, the farmer's market, started and still is on this green line. Today it's not the green line anymore, it's like downtown Beirut, like a fancy, nice part of the city. And we filled each of these bowls with like some kind of local ricotta that is called like Lebanon, you know, in Arabic, and cedar honey, and other people had to come, and we drew like this big line, you know, of green bread bowls, and other people had to come on the market day and eat, you know, break this bread bowl and eat a little bit of the ricotta and the honey and try, you know, to ingest the warm memory of other people. So it's always, it's not just about, you know, selling products. It's just about what the food and the history can have or can translate as of history and tradition. From all different expressions of tradition. Tradition is not a book that one opens and reads, right? It is, you know, architecture, it is costume. I think we are all dressed the same. I think architecture is all getting the same. Music is nearly all getting the same. But if there is one only expression of tradition that is still authentic and that people take with them all around, Italian didn't take their language with them around the world, right? They took pizza and pasta. Lebanese took their kibbeh and tabbouleh. Yesterday when we were preparing lunch, Kenneth, you know, Kenneth is from Finland, and he had a big smile on his face when Rene presented the Finnish kaviar, right? So it is the best expression of one is. What all these wonderful producers outside are doing. They have like jewels in their hand. They are so proud of like potato or an alg, you know, or of a seaweed. And all of these things are expression of this land. Nothing can be a better expression of me as an individual, of my history, and of my roots better than the food itself, better than the agriculture and what we do out of it, which is the food itself. So as you see in this picture, we got to November 2009, where we said, well, all of this is great, but there is one part that is still missing. There are many parts who are still missing, it's for sure. But one part that we wanted to add, which was the cuisine itself. I don't want the producer to be a supplier for individuals, you know, a supplier of goods, vegetables, or pot of jam, for individuals in their own houses or for chefs. You know, Rene is a great chef, you know, he's talking about the producers, but it's still not the producer that is cooking. What this is Mona and this is Nelly. This is Imm Ali and Nelly. She makes the best bread ever in the world. What does Ali prepares for lunch for her kids every single day? What does Nelly prepare? What does Suzanne prepare for her family every single day? So it was about like, what does these wonderful farmers and producers do as of traditional cuisine themselves in their own houses? So it was 2009, November, when we created this farmer's kitchen, like there's a farmer's market, it was a farmer's kitchen, where every single day, a different lady from a different village would come to like this, I'm sure you saw pictures of it here, like this big space in Beirut, 60 people seating, and two stainless steel counters at the end, not more than that, like a kitchen, like a home kitchen, nothing more, for the lady not to be intimidated by the place. Obviously, there's a team of chefs and people who are here to support this lady, but every single day, it's a different lady who comes from a different village of Lebanon and who would prepare her own cuisine from 8 in the morning until 12:30. At 12:30 we clean and set up the buffet on the same place where she was working. As of 1 till 4, you know, it is as she was, she is behind her counter and, you know, serving poor people 10 to 15 different dishes, the drinks and the desserts, and she's serving people as if she was hosting them at home. So every single day, a different lady from a different region who's telling, you know, a different story of a different region. So it is certainly about the land, certainly about the product, but I think first and foremost about the people themselves. About wonderful producers, wonderful cook, curious people, you know, why are you all here today? Why did you come? Where did you come from? What are you expecting? You know, what do you want to take with you? For me, it is, you know, like this, just a simple, small pot of honey, and it is, you know, the change that you want to see. How can each and every one of us, you know, be aware, be responsible, and bring the small drop that will add and will definitely make a change. Thank you.